Wheeler's up right now. Elise, Evelyn. We know that Pat's going to take Elise. Heaven Time.
Does he get to first pick it?
I don't know.
Is that worth it to first pick it?
At this point, because they put so much emphasis on Heaven Time's jungle pool, I'm actually surprised they banned out Lee Sin first, which means they probably actually won't first pick their jungler, because then they would first pick Pat Lee Sin, because that is his best champion.
Well, they'd ban Lee Sin both times anyway. They'd rather give it away elsewhere. The Wolf's Claw does pull a Ziggs ban, so no Nidalee removed, no Kassadin removed, no Lulu removed as well was another big one. So there's the first pick, Kassadin.
The question you posed earlier has been answered.
Yep.
Ava is in his champion pool.
Well, they're going to rush pick the Shyvana here, despite the fact that Trundle won the matchup last time. Elise does go through, and you figure, well, those mid laners that were contested, you get it for free at the end of the day because Kassadin got grabbed.
Yeah, Hauncer loves that Shyvana as well. Here's the thing, what does it leave Chump John with? His champion pool, so far, is kind of scarce in what he plays in solo queue. I'm not quite sure what he plays elsewhere, what he plays in team compositions.
Yeah, in the scrims.
Pretty much is around just Renekton, do well in the early game form. But then he's got like Gragas, Lee Sin, Teemo.
Hey,
the
it's
Teemo.
Good. It's good.
It's not so good against Shyvana, though.
It's the best champion in the game. Works in all cases.
Oh.
Well, Pat, he likes to play aggressively. If he can be that annoying, incredible force in the early game, we'll see what he ends up picking for that one. Evelyn going to work well in that case. Can
it's what's
got to get behind people. Sure. And Lucian going to go through for FNRL, stealing that from Hoodstomp.
Yep, not going to allow Hoodstomp to have that champion, but he would play Graves into that, given the opportunity.
And what's weird is one more time, AoE. Again, don't go for the, like, again, there's no early support pick. They're grabbing a champ that's not going to be contested at all with the Evelyn grab top lane as well. Could be the same thing. So taking their time to look more strategically for their top lane and support lane picks.
Yeah, they're going more counteractive. They pick up a couple things for themselves, like the Kassadin is just like, we want to snatch that away up. And then they start just playing counteractive after that.
Yeah, everything aside from Kassadin and Lucian has been counterpicked so far. So we'll see how this matches up. Hoodstomp does get Draven with the Lucian stolen away. Again, though, Cinda for LOD. And Team Lalpro, actually, for what it's worth, won't have to swap any champs at the end of the game.
Yeah, that's absolutely true, unless it's Draven in the jungle. You never know.
Yeah, at least AD carry Draven's jungle.
She's got range.
Zyrene.
Hey, at least support was a thing for like a week, too.
It was a thing for a while, actually.
Actually, yeah, Korea played it a little bit.
Yeah, I mean,
even better now.
I remember Daydreamin's breakout at least game. Got a quadra kill at like level 7. Unfortunately, it's still locked, but that was fun to watch. It's a good way to break onto the scene.
Yeah. But the Draven coming out here as an answer to the Lucian with the early game aggression, wouldn't be surprised to see a Nami paired with that so you can just snowball a little more. Morgana still on the table. Not a lot of support focus at all in terms of bans.
Yeah.
So they're just like, you can play whatever you want. You can have a Karma, you can have a Morgana, that's fine, and there it is.
Morgana Draven, I like a lot. He's going to be nice and safe, dealing damage all around. It's going to be the Irelia pick up against Shyvana here. So Hauncer went for Trundle against Shyvana. In this case, though, Chump John going for the more carry style with Irelia up here. Leona, Lucian, a lot of actually good engage there for AoE to set up a playground for Irelia, Kassadin, and Lucian to deal damage in.
Yeah, there's a lot of things to consider here. They do get Kassadin on AoE, and they get Irelia, so they're looking for that late game. Pat's going to try to facilitate the early game and allow them to get that little extra bump so they don't have that mid-game hump.
Mm-hmm.
And Lalpro, though, Scatter the Weak.
Yep.
Elise Cocoon, Darkbinding. They have an infinite stun combo.
Yes, they do.
It's legitimately infinite stun.
Yeah.
If you can catch somebody, you're just like, oh, one, two, three, one,
four,
two,
five,
three.
Yeah. Just over and over and over and repeated once again.
Don't,
so
they'll probably never get it because you'll die by like stun
well,
number two.
Sure, yeah.
But the fact that there's a Draven here, they willingly pick the Morgana into it with the Black Shield. They keep him safe, keep him out of engage.
Yeah.
Because Solar Flare is one of the Draven's one of the easiest AD carries to catch with Leona.
Yes.
You have Solar Flare, you have Zenith Blade, you have all of these tools to get to him.
Generally only Solar Flare, actually, because you can stand aside the Zenith Blade. A practiced Draven player can completely shut down a Jarvan, a Xin Zhao, a Pantheon, a Leona. All of those can be stopped away. But if you're an Invisible Evelyn, if you're going to Solar Flare first and it doesn't get Black Shielded, then you've got ways in. So I do want to see how well this Draven actually stuffs those engages and stops them. Even Irelia. I mean, Irelia's another one. Again, where you can, it's a lot harder to block her Q. It goes so fast. But there's a lot of things that Hoodstomp could stuff in this game to keep him safe and just to deal the maximum damage in the team fights. I do want to watch that. I think that's the individual player I'd watch the most for how this game tells.
LOD?
LOD and Hoodstomp together, I guess. Both of them could knock back, but like those are the high damage. Yeah, well, sure. The old AD carry for Lelpro. I understand you on that one. But yeah, those are the guys this game hinges on to me.
Okay. Okay. I can definitely see that. And I'm on that page with you now.
Yeah.
It's like
the Lelpro page.
Yes. The Lelpro page is being like, you know what? LOD, Hoodstomp. LOD, see if he can get another solo kill in lane. Hoodstomp, see what he can do in the laning phase. And if he shows up to the fights, because that was one of their big problems, was that he was off CSing.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't even have that great.
That's true. Well, we'll see what pans out for these guys. We are on to the Rift here. Lelpro, I want to see also how the Syndra pick plays off fighting a different champion here, fighting the Kassadin. Because the magic damage shield, because of the passive as well, because he might just buy some MR, this Kassadin could be very resilient against LOD while he's just dealing his targeted damage over and over again.
Here's the thing, though. LOD, he obviously knows the power spikes of Syndra very, very well, the ins and outs of her.
Yeah.
And they didn't ban her away, even though it was extremely potent in the last game. And now it's up against a very weak early mid-game champion. Kassadin's mid-game is a little better. But now, oh my lord, you had to wait for that late game, and you have to hope you didn't feed Syndra three kills.
Yeah. I mean, this game is, yeah, if we're going to watch Syndra and Draven on one side, you're definitely going to watch Kassadin on the other. Early invade by Lelpro does not get them spotted. A defensive pink for Heaven Time, again, for these guys.
Yeah, they definitely have the better level one, so there's no reason for them not to. You have Elise, you have Morgana, you have Draven, you have the Syndra up against Kassadin, whose level one is extremely weak. Irelia is the same boat.
Lelpro seeking the 2v2 there, and unless you were literally watching if the ward went down, AoE doesn't know that there's that aggressive ward there. They put it in the Fog of War, and while you could maybe see the particle, no one puts their map there at the start of the game. So
yeah,
we'll see.
You would see like the little...
You would see the wisp.
The blip.
Yeah, you can see the blips of the wards going down the little like wispy trail, but there's... I would pretty well guess
they
AoE
sniff it out. It's going to be a 2v2 top? Actually, AoE is going to invade with four with their top laner still here and look for that numbers advantage, but all of Lelpro is actually on this side of the map.
And they don't even walk by wards right now. Pat's going to spot Hoodstomp. Nope. I don't think he's got seen.
Hoodstomp didn't see Pat. Pat saw Hoodstomp.
All right, that's going to mean the red buff there for Team AoE. And meanwhile, Lelpro runs right through a ward and says, all right, well, we're going to take your blue buff away. So a complete trade on this one as they cross paths, ships in the night in this one.
Oh, they're going to see each other, though, as they walk to the minion wave.
Uh-oh.
Hoodstomp just hanging out. Oh, there behind you.
Ellen's going to get his way in. Evanarl going to have a big amount of damage there on that one. LOH going to show up. Doesn't hit the binding. This is not a really good fight for Lelpro. LOH got to be real careful on this one. Elements does not take much damage. It's a good start to this game for Team AoE.
Yeah, they get that advantage in the lane. And top lanes are very, very susceptible to this. And
they're looking for more in the top lane, though. LOH taking a bunch of damage in the underneath the turret. We didn't get to see it, but I was watching the minimap there.
Chump John's behind them.
Yeah, he's been waiting for this one, too. Exhaust is down. It's still healing two flashes, but...
No, he's TPing. He's out of there. He can't give up that much CS to Hanser. Jumped on too conscious of his lane, especially when he gets two levels up. He's like, yeah, I know what I can do.
And there you're seeing the trades there. LOD losing half his health bar there to the Wolf's Claw. Of course, Flask start for Kassadin. It's going to be pretty decent on this one overall. And under the turret they are. So Heaven Time going to be first to get the double buffs here. Of course, Pat did cash in a bunch of time ganking top.
Here's the thing. He gets double blues, whereas Pat gets double reds.
That is not very good for Evelynn.
Yeah, Evelynn's passive does give her mana regen, though.
Yeah, I
but
still feel like you
cooldown reduction is something he needs in the early game.
Well, even with the passive, you can really in the jungle.
Yeah.
The fact that he walked all the way across the map to get his next buff meant his mana bar was full. But if you're chain clearing, you
Yeah, absolutely.
Without Spirit Center, without blue.
Early game, the blue is definitely a little better if you're going to be farming up the jungle.
Oh, yeah.
Red, better for ganking, but it's Elise.
Already good at that.
Yes.
Generally speaking.
Amazing at that. Look at that. DeWolf's Claw out CSing LOD.
Well, that's because of the push.
Yeah, he's pushing him under the turret pretty hard.
Look how well LOD's like set up most of those.
Oh.
Yeah, ooh. Didn't spot him. I don't think. Maybe the pink ward saw him.
He said ships passing in the night, except one of them is invisible. More fog cover.
All right, so a submarine passing a ocean liner in
there
the night.
There you go. See if you can sink him like Titanic.
Oh, wow, the binding miss. So Elements goes in. Nice black shield's going to keep LOH pretty safe, but still some damage going through. Now DeWolf's Claw's got to be careful. Flashing away. The flash cocoon for Heaven Time is going to land. The burst comes out. First blood comes in for LOD. What a great gank down there in the mid lane, even with the flash coming in there. That's awesome.
So it wasn't a solo kill, but they're still setting up LOD for success. There's a little bit of a pause coming out right now,
mm-hmm.
but in the meantime, Great gank there.
Yes.
Great presence of mind from Heaven Time to know that he can flash, just pick it up for himself, and set up LOD for success. Now he probably doesn't have to visit that lane anymore unless he wants to just keep Kassadin down.
And that can be really worthwhile.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, deaths, they will deny you. Yeah, I mean, death will deny basically an extra minion wave. This early on in the game, it's basically a minion wave of attacks, and that will put Kassadin a bit down, and it will put Syndra a bit ahead. I still feel like it's hard to guarantee the 1v1 kill. Because Kassadin ran MR blues, because he has, again, all the stats I mentioned, you can max the Q, you have the passive as well, so I feel like he'd be pretty hard to kill. But hey, maybe it does work out. We do actually, though, have a replay if we want to go back through that gank, though, and see what happened.
So we're going to see it here. Heaven Time actually comes in from the same side that DeWolf's Claw actually retreats to, and the Ignite gives him vision, so he knows that he can flash and light up the cocoon perfectly to guarantee them the kill at that point. So
yeah.
That's the flash, too. Which is really big, because that means repeat ganks are just going to be even more effective.
Exactly. It'll be so easy for Syndra to set a gank up pre-6 by just landing the stun and letting Elise walk in on that one. And that was actually a concern to me, was watching Kassadin pushing in. Because when we first puts the damage through. But outside of that, that's going to be a difficulty to actually catch people out here.
Yeah. And speaking of catching people out, though, Volpro have all the tools, all the cards in their hands.
They do.
With the three CC members, the jungler, the middle laner, and support. So when the late game hits, if the vision control for AoE isn't impeccable, they're going to get picked off.
Yes. Oh, they got to be good about this one. We'll see if they can do it. Last game, AoE bought a whole bunch of wards and generally did a really good job with that one. They've got to keep it up here in game two, and they've got to win this one if they want to stay in the tournament.
Yeah, and for Lulpro, instead of keeping it up, can they keep the cast in down?
Ooh. Speaking of going up and down, dodges upwards and gets away from the dark binding, so he's going to be okay. Morgana can't keep him down. Shum John, though, his health bar is going down. Haunts are going up on him. Min's going to be reaching up to this turret very soon.
League of Legends.
Two more will fall down.
Ups and downs.
14 gold going up into the pockets of Haunter. He's leveled up to 5. Chump John not quite there. He's a level down.
He's going straight after the turret now. Chump John's going to have none of that. His HP's bar is going up.
Yep.
All right, we're done.
Ten style healing up quite nicely. Haunter going to back off of that one. Ten style goes back down. Now DeWolf's Claw level 4.
So just from the kill assist and the fact that there's a CS advantage in this bottom lane with the bullying, Volpro has a 1,000 gold lead.
Look at that.
LOD already pushing the advantage he created with the help of Heaven Time.
Oh my gosh.
Straight onto the Wolf's Claw. He knows Syndra's power spikes. And look at that. Heaven Time's back.
Yeah.
He's sitting here for two reasons. One, Evelynn will most likely come here. And two,
can he land it?
Line it up.
Ooh, good juke right there. Some more damage comes through, but Wolf's Claw's got to be so careful. His recoil only got him a Ruby Crystal and a ward he can't even put down yet. He's been too pushed back to do any of that, so he's just losing health bars
level
over and over.
Level 6 for LOD right now.
Yeah, there's going to be the chance. Ooh, that nearly hit from Elements there. He's going to get hit back for this one, though. Hood stomp. Going to be happy. Elements blowing all of his cooldowns there. Plugging forward back in the second brush again. Dodge the Dark Binding. Good damage from Evan Arel, though. They're finding ways to just hit this Draven in the backside because they're all dodging bindings.
Pat, that's a pink ward.
That's a pink ward.
Okay. He was so startled by he didn't know what to do. He was panicking.
Walk back and forth a couple of times.
Ah.
Takes it down.
Ah. So LOD, he has his ultimate. If he can line up a stun combo after the Q shield is worn off, he'll be able to line up a kill.
Ooh, the stun nearly lands. He was maybe 100 units off on that one on the Q cast right there. Keeps him safe, though, and the push comes in. Looks like Heaven Time is going to allow LOD to recall back.
Because they have this advantage in the mid lane on both their jungler and their mid laner, they can go ahead and just apply this pressure.
Yeah.
There's no chance of retaliation here.
Stun on a Pat, big damage, forces the flash. He knew he would go down if that stun landed. Smart read right there, but still, you're seeing how rough this lane is now. Element's taking a bunch of damage as well. Speaking of how well Draven's doing now, look at that one. 48-49 in minions, so pretty equal there, and there's a bunch of adoration waiting to be used.
Down bottom, though, Chump John already blew his teleport to get back into lane, and he's already getting bullied out.
Wow. Yeah, Haunter, these guys trading ultimates for it as well. Again, jumping in, but big damage comes through, not quite in turret range. Haunter bringing his health bar so dangerously low. No potions left as well for Aurelia. If someone shows, she dies.
Yeah, but up top is where Heaven Time's going to show, right on top of that ward.
All right, so no gank in the bottom lane, but top lane. Yeah, good sweeper in there, safe.
Thank you.
And now he's going to go invade the jungle and see if he can take it to Pat, who's in that top lane, though, because he expects a gank there.
He's going to slink around. No pink wards there. Is going to keep him safe. Haunter. He's already reconnected. That was what that pause was for. No big worries in this one.
Pat's like right next to Hoodstomp.
And he's sick.
Down his neck.
He'll get the ulti without Black Shield. And then Elements will have to choose the right target afterwards after Black Shield goes down. He's going to go in. There's a Hoodstomp blown on that one. But LOH, I don't know if they can really get that target down. Oh, they break through the Black Shield. And Pat didn't even ult for this one. He's waiting around on this one. But now the bottom lane fight. Haunter putting Chump John down below half HP. The burnout dealing very significant damage. The flash in traded. No cooldowns back up, but it's another recall forced.
Whew, that was so close. If it took a burnout and an auto attack had gone through off of the flash, Chump John would be done for. Mm-hmm. But he doesn't have his teleport, so there's actually going to be a big lead here now for Haunter. They're going to wait and let this minion wave just take out.
Yeah, and I got to say, I'm a fan of what Heaventime did there. After the first gank, he kept showing up mid in the right way. Like, okay, he tried to gank once, didn't happen, that's fine. They knew they had such a lead, you know, across those two mid laners, that he's like, if I just push, yeah, we'll get the turret, deny CS, because he can't defend it on the turret. You're seeing a 35, 36 minion lead there. Blue buff, uncontested there. Bottom side of the map is owned right now by LOLPRO. They could have gone dragon if they wanted to. They'd rather get the outer turret. They can get the dragon later.
Yeah, and the fact that Heaventime continued to push that advantage in the mid, a kill on Syndra, an assist on Elise versus an Evelynn, who's not very good in 2v2s compared to Elise, is really big, and it was really good on them to recognize that. It was kind of putting the crowbar into the box so that they can pry their entire lead open.
Well, let's stop getting pushed out of lane on that one, though. And there comes the engage. The sun's going to land on a Chump John. Nicely played for that one. The gank was waiting for it, and the fact that Chump John even fought gave that kill away. Plus the turret, LOLPRO owned the bottom side of the map.
Heaventime's doing a really good job of going to the lanes that have a tiny advantage and just snowballing it.
Yeah.
Right there, they have a 3.5k gold lead now because of this. He went bottom, even though there was a CS lead already for Haunter. They knew the teleport had been used previously. The flash was down because of that. And Elise, against somebody who doesn't have flash, can't flash the cocoon. It's a guaranteed lockup if he aims it correctly. Went mid. Look at LOD's CS. He has 30 up over DeWolf's Claw. DeWolf's Claw is now in that point where Kassadin will struggle against Syndra quite a bit.
Yeah, he has to respect the burst damage so much there. Even with points in Q to put that shield up, he's still got to be careful. Pat puts a pink ward down. They want to get some control over this dragon area, but we're really just kind of waiting for AoE's team comp to turn on there. You've got a long way to go. Evan Arel actually picked up a pickaxe there, which is fine. I like it just to get some lane pressure there, but it's going to be even longer now until he actually combines any items. There's this gigantic, like, 20-minute long lull for AoE.
Yeah, and the fact that he Lucian's build, you don't use a pickaxe until about third item.
Yeah.
Because you go for Trinity Force most of the time.
Yeah, it's very, very true. It's going to be an interesting thing to watch for then if you can pick up any of this.
Maybe even fourth item sometimes.
Typically not, because even then you'd get like third item eye edge sometimes.
Yeah. Last Whisper.
Yeah, I mean, Last Whisper is the typical one.
Yeah.
We'll see what he eventually turns it into. I've seen Last Whisper second occasionally. But that's a pretty rare sight. Well, top lane is being pressured, though. AoE are using the fact that this was their advantage lane to keep the push going. Interestingly enough, LOLPRO actually put that as their junk lane. Haunter just stays there by himself, but that does mean they've got four guys on the bottom side if they want to contest Dragon.
Gotta ask them, what are they going to do with all that junk in that top lane?
Yep.
See what ends up happening. Evan RL went straight after it. Haunter didn't use his teleport to get there, so actually they have a Dragon number advantage right now. Bottom lane to the bottom.
Yes, they did.
Get control over it for LOLPRO.
And there we go. Dragon being attempted. You know, at this point, AoE knows they're starting it, but unless you're going for the flash smite over the wall, it flashes down. Pat cannot contest this, so LOLPRO, with the lane swap, they do pick up Dragon here 12 minutes in. It's going to respawn about 18 minutes there. AoE will eventually pick up top lane turret for it. So now, LOLPRO, what can you do with the numbers lead outside of trading Dragon for outer turret?
Nope, I'm not LOLPRO, so I can't really answer, but looking at it right now, the Kassadin, DeWolf's Claw, 12 minutes in, just has Catalyst. He's looking to just survive now. He's already given up a kill, which is a huge advantage for LOD, because we saw him just pry that game open last time.
Mm-hmm. See what else they can do with this one. DeWolf's Claw stays alive with the
straight through the shield.
Shield there. Yeah, At least it's tanking the Q, though. So he's not taking health damage when that happens. Elements, though, goes in. Heaven Time, gotta be a bit careful on this one, but Haunter just goes in for that one. Solar Flare's gonna be nice, though, and land on these guys. MNRL trying to help keep the team alive. Here comes Pat as well. You were right, and this could be rough. LOH flashes in. Who's gonna stay for? Looks like he wants Element, but misses the Dark Binding. Thinking Heaven Time.
They're
gonna be there. Nice CC from LOD, and that's gonna be some damage. MNRL forced to run away very far. This one, Chump John, though, shows up and turns that kill back around. AoE find their way into this fight. Chump John might have gotten the reset off that one, but here comes the Wolf's Claw. Finds more CC. Can he get more on that one? Nice cocoon. It's going to be the disengage, but not the fight they wanted. There comes the engage again for the Wolf's Claw. Nice repel to get him back out of this one. LOH should stay safe, but again, not the fight LawPro wanted.
Yeah, they ended up losing two members there, actually. For LawPro, Draven had nothing to do with that, so it was a 4-on-5 in the overall. And very staggered in the movement for this fight starts now. We see Syndra already coming up, as well as Cassidy. And Chump John eventually his teammates in. Now Heaven Time gets his red stolen by Pat.
Yeah. I don't know why they all in for Leona in that one. She had her W on. Like, Shyvana went past the AD carry to go hit somebody else. That was a weird choice to me, to be honest, in that one. That I don't know if that was really the right target to go for, but. And you saw they did get, kind of hit pretty hard in that fight. Looks like Draven, but Lucian might be cashing into the pickaxe early, actually. Yes, he might go Bloodthirster anyway, but he could also just rush the Infinity Edge there and be a very high, just auto-attack-focused champion. I've seen a number of Dravens, mostly in Europe, actually, will go Phantomancer over Triforce and get, you know, Eye Edge fourth and be a more standard auto-attack AD carry instead of being a spell slingy. And if you go Eye Edge first, that's definitely the build you go for here.
It means Lucian wants to carry. It means Splitstomp wants, or MRL wants to put that on.
That's the late game build.
Yeah. Late game, starting with the early game.
So. Yeah. He's starting the early game early, or sorry, starting the late game early.
Well, yeah, they have a late game comp, though, because they have
true.
Aurelion cast in. So
that's
they're going to be getting to that point. So if he goes Eye Edge first, then when they get to the mid game, and it's like Kassadin has hit level 11, hit level 16,
16
you have
big
power spikes for yourself.
Well, then it's going to be how long can they make that happen, though? How well can they trade objectives back and forth, keep those things going neutral? Because the top lane, which was in the bottom of the map this time, the Australian top lane, did get crushed. It went really poorly. A great gank came in to pick up the team's second kill. The turret went down early on as well. The 1v1 was going poorly for Chump John. The mid lane was arguably even worse. 35 minion deficit there by about 13 minutes into the game. That's really rough as well. So then all you're really looking at is, okay, well, the only place you're getting any advantage from is from your AD carry. And the only time you even get any global objectives is when they go for a dragon, you counterattack with a turret. How long can you hold into this game to make it to late game?
Yeah.
And game one was 55 minutes. To be fair, a late game comp would work in that case. But you've got to be very concerned with, do we lose the game in 25 minutes if they keep pushing?
Yeah, that's the adaptation, too. It's a 55-minute game against this team. Well, let's pick a late game team comp. They're down in gold currently for AoE. So that's what they're booking on right now. They gave up the dragon to LawPro, they gave up the positioning to LawPro, and they've given up three turrets as well. There's CS advantage in every lane except for jungle and AD carry. Mm-hmm. Pat is coming down bottom right now. There's still this turret for them to take. And Hoodstomp, if you can kill Draven and stop him from cashing in, it's definitely beneficial.
There's definitely the Evelynn in the wings. He's got both summoners. The Hoodstomp, takes a bad trade right there. That was not the right move, but he's going to lifesteal pretty heavily underneath the turret. Looks like no dive's going to be available. You see Evelynn.
It's LOH.
Yeah, goes back around. Well, LOH got to be careful. Can he flash the wall or anything? He can ult, but that's going to be it. He goes down to elements in that fight, and now it's the Elise forced to run away. LOD in the wings as well, forced around. Nice dodge there by the Wolfsclash. He keeps himself safe. Solar Flare does get dodged around as well. There's going to be the knockback, but Elements gets in, finds the stun. Big burst comes out. Summoner heal, keeping his teammates alive. The Wolfsclaw is around, though. Puts some CC down onto Hoodstomp. He's got to be a bit careful. Their health bars do stay up, though.
And there's still this Tier 1 turret. And meanwhile, Chump John is doing Hauntzer in the top lane. Teleport was not available for Hauntzer to just jump right in because he had the pressure. Chump John to stun him with the Equilibrium Strike because he got him low. Mm-hmm. The kite backwards from LawPro. It's really good there. There was no flash available for LOH. He ended up using it previously for the
engage, previous fight,
which was what they communicated, because Pat was all over him with a red buff. He's like, yeah. And he burned his ultimate, too. So they get a lot out of that.
Yeah. You know what's funny? What we just saw there is the AD carry tried to last hit the turret. There's actually no reason to last hit a turret.
stats, extra stats.
But they keep trying. It's great. It's like the instinct of an AD carry. He's like, it's going down. I better shoot this. And it like literally means nothing.
Yeah, if everybody leaves and the AD carry stays there, then he gets all the gold.
Yeah. See, like last hit or not. Doesn't even matter.
Yeah.
But he wanted to look cool and he missed it. What a chump, Evan. Should rename.
Two.
Chump Evan.
Chump Evan? Yeah. You got Chump John, though.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I picked the name.
Okay. But I don't know. I don't know if they're related, though.
They're not. It's not a surname. It's just a title.
It'd really suck if your surname was Chump.
Yeah. And it sucked for a title, too, but they chose it. Chump John losing half his health right there. Haunter is trying repeatedly to push him around the map and push him down the lane as well. Doesn't actually clear the full wave, but keeps on going forward. Looks like he wants to kill these minions off on top of that one. What's interesting is this will actually build up a... potentially build up a decent hefty minion wave just because his wave is held up by those three remaining minions.
Mm-hmm. And now he'll clear this next one.
Yeah, I wonder where it'll actually end up meeting. It's going to be delayed slightly. Probably around the... somewhere between Tier 1 and Tier 2 turret, which is not a normal meeting point, but it's where it's going to be.
Now we're seeing elements off on the side. He wants to clear these wards out. Ooh. Possibly engage in the near future.
Pat shows himself. I'm surprised that he actually did, just because he has a chance to get the sideways engage. But all of Lulpro are grouped up now in the mid lane. Of course, there's not a ton of wave clear now that the illusion ulti has been used. He'll get some of the minions, but only two really here. Elements in the front line. It looks like AoE will be able to hold on for now. Lulpro not pushing in too hard. There's the flank attempt from Evelynn.
We do see Chump John is also in this fight. He can TP in from a different angle, but I don't think that's going to be the route he's taking. Instead, oh, they saw Pat with the pink ward.
Not quite the CC landing, though. He's going to be safe. Put some damage out on a Haunter. Chump John's around. AoE are grouped up for the dragon. They've got to be careful. If this engage comes in, it could be bad. Heaven Time gets caught out, forced to rappel up, and there comes the battle. Draven ulti burn. Nice solar flare in the back lines, and out goes the team. LOH gets exploded. One for zero so far. The cash in goes to Draven. He gets a whole bunch of money before he starts burning down from the ignite. Actually, they will trade two for two in this fight, but it's getting worse and worse now for Lulpro. The slow's coming in. Pat dives forward. He'll pick up another kill for the team. Look at that. Actually, sorry, four for won this battle, AoE winning hard.
And now they're going to get the dragon and even up the gold and actually take a little bit of an advantage now for the first time in the game. Last game, they were ahead all game long, and now this game, they end up coming out on top with a late game team comp. So now they're back into this game because of this funnel engage here.
Mm-hmm.
Lulpro. Yeah, we see Haunter's a little too far forward. LOD actually overextends to try and help, but doesn't realize the number advantage in time.
Yeah.
Has to back up, but blows his flash and gets taken out anyway.
Yeah, I mean, Heaven Time getting caught and reduced to half HP before the fight even started was massive right there. No one could help Haunter in the back line, right? He was just alone and then dying, because you can't really solo AD carries his top laners until you get, I would say, about the two item mark is where you kind of spike above them. Because you max out two abilities by that point around level 13, and that's when you go in pretty hard there, but was not the chance there. So look at this, AoE. 600 gold down, 500 gold down, three kills up, definitely the momentum in their favor now. And they can cash in pretty massively. Let's see what they can get.
Yeah, Kassadin is hitting those power spikes now. The Rod of Ages is continuing to build up, and their playstyle is still sticking true. Look at all of the pink wards and green wards in their inventory, but Chump John.
Wow, Haunter with a red buff, though, looking great. Chump John tried to slow him with the Ruin King, but the nice stun's going to keep him safe. Haunter, no flash, does have W. Can he get in range? It doesn't last very long. And uh-oh, there's Elise in the wings as well. Can't quite get himself into this one. Just kills away wards. Knows that dive was not to be. Instead, this team wants to grab away the blue buff. They do hold a gold lead for what it's worth, but here comes the engage from Area of Effect. And he's stunned under Wolf's Claw. Q shield comes down. Haunter off in the wings as well, though.
Chump John has TP. That's his way back into this fight.
Spike comes in. Heaven Time does grab that one. The heals coming in from Aurelia. Will she teleport? The engage comes in, though. Draven ulti by the wings as well. Hoodstomp going to fight Evanarel 1v1 down the bottom side of the map. But there comes Chump John to turn that fight around. And Hoodstomp goes down. 2-for-1 battle. Lulpro now not in the right spot. LOD makes it a 0-for-3. And they're forced to run away.
And they're pinging. I was like, they're pinging Baron? No, they aren't pinging Baron. They're going straight for the middle turret here, the last outer turret for them to take for AoE. And they're clawing themselves back into this game and taking advantages after they win every fight.
Clawing their way back in. Here we go. Let's watch the fight again.
Yeah, the TP here, we see that Hoodstomp actually comes in from the right, and he's alone. They zone off the team with elements, just causing a lot of pressure, and they pick off Hoodstomp with the help of Chump John. They end up going 3-0 here. Very good pickup in the end.
Yeah, absolutely impressive right there. If it weren't for Chump John, though, that would have been the 1v1 fight. Problem is, he had someone who could help.
Right? Yep.
Problem is, like, if you're a diver, if you're a top lane bruiser, typically those guys dive the back line. If you can get there without peel available, you will wreak havoc. The fight before last, Hanser was the lone in the back line against four people. He died for it. This time, Chump John gets to 2v1 the AD carry. It's the right choice to make.
Yeah. And, Hoodstock, you know, made it very available. The
yes,
very available
he did.
Option.
Yes,
he
did.
He was not behind his team. He was not a back line. He was a flanker in that fight. In the jungle, not the best position to be in at all as an AD carry.
The thing is, like, Hoodstomp's a cocky player. I know we talked about him in the round of 10, saying, if I knew it was this easy, I would have never left I never would have left CLG Black. That was his quote. If I knew it was going to be this easy to make LCS, I never would have left CLG Black. And, you know, that kind of hubris, you saw it right there. Went pretty hypey, thought he'd 1v1, didn't notice the teleport. Got, you know, he paid for it.
He's got a Brutalizer, too. He paid for that.
Yes, he did.
As well.
1337 gold.
A little different than what you typically see on a Draven. Don't know if he's expecting.
It's a good snowball build. Ooh, there comes Solar Flare. Two man slow on this one. Hoodstomp's got to be a bit careful. He's running away, dealing really good damage to Pat, though. But Pat will maybe die to the Ignite. Yes, he will. But the fight continues. One for one so far. Great damage from Wolf's Claw. Still putting pain in Hanser. Again, the Soul Diver can only do so much damage. He does pull aggro, though. Allows the team time to hit the Wolf's Claw, who will go down. Hanser perfectly tanks it out. And now the stun's going to land onto two. He's going to keep chasing. Binding hits Elements. But they've got to be careful because the counterattack comes in from FNRL. Big damage comes through. 3-on-3. Can they land any more? There's the jump in for Elise. Finds another one. 3-for-2 overall the battle. And now they're going to go for the turret.
And it's just a swing back to the other side right now. This is like last game. You'd win one fight and then you'd not do so well the next. And the other team would outplay you. And right there, LolPro comes up big, going 2-for-1. And they 2-for-3.
3-2, yeah.
2-for-3. People respawn too quickly. It's so early in the game.
Yeah.
Yeah, Pat flanks from the side right now, and they put a lot into him. They have to burn through his shield and his Hex Drinker, but he gets obliterated by the Ignite on the backside. And Kassadin, here's the thing. DeWolf's Claw uses so much to try and get Heaven Time, and he doesn't even get him. Right here. Rift walks,
does
the damage, and Heaven Time, look at that. The kill goes down, and Heaven Time actually has the...
Dangerous Game is pretty standard.
So he gets himself a little extra HP to re-engage the fight. So when he's able to just apply pressure here, because it's now a 3-on-3 with a health advantage, pretty big. It means he went really deep into the offense.
Yeah. I mean, one big thing with that fight is keep in mind, Heaven Time's 4-0-4. So he was really big in that fight. At that battle, he had Aegis plus the not the Giant's Belt, but the Ancient Golem. So he was tankier, especially magic resist-wise, than the Wolf's Claw expected. Especially with Wolf's Claw being held down early on. His Rod of Aegis not even fully stacked at this point. Slightly under the damage he expected to have right there because of the early game performance of both those players, missed the calculation, gave up a kill because of it.
Yeah, both junglers have been doing a lot of work across the map that they are a little ahead of the stat curve than you would expect at this time for the junglers. 24 minutes in, 100% kill participation on Elise, two items, boots, and you're on your way to a third, which would probably be Randuin's, so he's got his resistances covered. But at the same time, you look at Elise, who they put a lot into, and they ended up having to blow the Hex Drinker, just a lot of extra damage in the Ignite to take off.
Yeah.
Beat her in the end. They get themselves a red onto Pat there.
He's good. They're still counter-juggling.
These tiny victories here.
Yeah.
Back and forth. And then sometimes the big victories. But right now, it's Dragon. It's going to be the next fight, and who can end up being victorious there. AoE can get themselves back into the game. LolPro can start to pull away.
It's a 5-on-4. Hanser does not have teleport, and AoE are all. There's not even a turret to
get.
There's almost no way they get anything for this. So Dragon securely grabbed mid lane the pressure, but there's no tier 2 there. Instead, LolPro, this is such a good move. They go to rest control over the path between mid lane and top lane. These guys look to secure tier 2 top.
Now they got to go ahead and clear this wave out. Now,
they've got to go fast.
Yeah, it's going to be gone by the time they get there, but they can get them on the retreat if they want to fight it.
Well, there's wards that spot this one. LOH going to walk into the front lines. No silence. Does get the binding onto Pat. They spot this one. More CC comes in. Draven ulti as well. Just to say, guys, back off. Don't you dare try for this one. So tier 2 for the Dragon. LolPro do not feel confident enough to keep going for the inhibitor. They could have held the inside track and forced AoE around. In fact, they will do this. They buy some time. The stun on a Wolf's Claw. This could be bad. Good damage comes through. Black Shield and Heaven Time now. This inhibitor turret losing a lot of health, but Chump John's ready to flank. Do they stay for the turret? They don't quite. Yes, they do. Turret comes in, but there's the battle. Shields pop, and there comes the engage. A lot of burst, and Chump John, he goes down first. 1-for-0 so far. Hanser's going to flash in the back lines. burning down with the ignite. He's gonna just barely go down with the last tick. One for one, top laners go down, but that's two turrets for Dragon.
And LawPro has cracked the base. They were the first team to crack the base last game too.
Well, see if they can keep the move on going, though. Inhibitor down to one quarter. That's going to fall as well, 26 and a half minutes in. And would you look at that, the tenacity to say, you know, we're going to go in, not be stunned by your rotations, and to make it in.
And they end up winning a fight in the same spot they won a fight last game.
Yep.
End up getting that turret for themselves. Get the blue buff.
To LOH.
LOH.
Whatever.
That's all right.
Their own is up. They can give it to LOD.
Cooldown.
He's got to be careful, though. He is alone sweeping away wards. LOH flashes the wall just to get away a little bit faster. He'll be able to do that. But Area of Effect, they know there's no mana on most of these guys. They're going to start Baron for it. TP comes in from Chump John. And now LulPro, without big mana bars and blue buff on the wrong character, Elements it's going to be the chance. Oh, man. This could be the Baron. Heaven Time has Flash. He has Repel. He can go for the steal and get out. CC comes in for Elements, but a bit early. Black Shield comes down. There's the Repel. They
Stop
get off,
the
but this is way too early for him. The Draven only comes by. Who's going to get the Smite? It gets picked up there by Pat for AoE and the one for zero. Elements leading the charge. They're going to go in for this one. Kassadin will join the team soon, but the Burst turns it back around. 4v4 on the map. Baron in the disengage.
You could see that DeWolf's Claw wanted to go over the wall, and Pat wanted to flash to help Elements, but the call was don't help.
Yep.
And he sacrificed himself so that the rest of his team could get out with Baron. Because if they had continued the fight there, LulPro would have won. They had the sooner back. They had just gotten out of there. Their combat stats are ready to go.
Yeah, you don't want to burn a bunch of flashes to join a 4v4. Mm. Generally, your position tends to be pretty poor in that case. So I trust them to have made the right call on this one. Area of Effect now picking up what they can from the rest of the map. Red buff going over to their AD carry, who did, by the way, just sit on pickaxe. He is just going for the standard Bloodthirster Trinity Force build. Interesting, then. To me, at that point, you just should just go with Doran's Blade instead of the pickaxe if you're not going to use it. But
he just sold it. Oh, and never mind. He turned
it. He bought Last Whisper. Okay, well, now it cashed in.
Now he doesn't have a Doran.
He sold Doran's Blade to get the combine in.
Yes.
Right, that tells me, though, if that happens, they're looking to make a real move right now, because you miss out on the Doran stats for the rest of the game there, because you don't sell it for a good while longer. So, Glasses for Gold, the...
Draven sold his, too, so we could go ahead and have some wards in his inventory.
That's a good choice, though. Selling for wards is always the right choice.
He doesn't have any, so...
He ran out. Whatever. Next time he gets a kill, though, he's actually picked up a number of deaths there, Hoodstop. He did cash in before his first death, but his adoration not going to be all that high now anymore. It'll be a few hundred gold, but nothing like 1,000.
Now they're going to get this turn for themselves. Baron on AoE, but map pressure in favor of LulPro. They have super minions pouring down the top lane. They want to fight now.
Flash engage lands onto four. There's a solar flare as well. Big damage coming in, and Hoodstop goes down first, but there's Haunter in the back line. Looks for Chump John. He gets just barely enough damage to push them away, but the team stays alive. Wolf's Claw, though, takes the cocoon, makes that a one for two, but low health bars on AoE. Heaven Time does catch up, though. Can they get a little bit more? No cocoon really can land because there's minions in the way. Nice stun, and he positions to land that cocoon after all. Black Shield keeps him a bit safer. Elements takes big damage, and the Q comes out, making it two for two despite the Baron buff on AoE.
And the fact that they have this huge minion wave knocking against their Nexus right now. And now, at the same time,
that turret's losing a lot of health, which is going to give some time to hit down that bottom inhibitor. You're seeing the health bar go down. It's a 3v1. They're not afraid of getting caught right there, but they should be a little bit afraid. Heaven Time's low. Pat comes in, no CC available, and they can back out.
Call to go from AoE. You're going to see it right here. Because the minion wave is pushing, because there's super minions in that top lane, you have to go right now. It was a great engage there by Pat. And then the back line, just so much going on there, where EvanRL's focus is Haunter instead of dealing damage to the back line of LulPro. Heaven Time, LOD, pretty untouched here. Mm-hmm. Both AD carries. Well, one AD carry going down. We saw the Draven once again, Hoodstomp, adding another little check mark to that death category. Elements barely getting picked up there by LOD, who's playing that Syndra perfectly again.
Yeah, 6-3 and 300, not 100%. If you added deaths, it would be 100%, but that doesn't really count. I gotta say, very impressive play right there. The fact that LulPro kept their back line alive and at full health for that entire fight, the exhaust on Wolf's Claw, the fact that Chump John's actually dealing with the diver, Haunter died to allow that chase to happen just because the health bar difference is there. So I'm not even all that sad about his performance in that fight. Team LulPro do end up going plus two turrets on that entire engage. The kills went equal. So it still holds as a 2,000 gold lead, and Baron buff timing out rapidly.
I'd say in the Challenger Series, though, this is one of the closest games that we've seen.
Yeah.
In terms of duration and how long they keep it close. Because this will end up being somewhere around that 40-minute game again, where does the team that has the better CC and won last game off of communication and the proper calls beat AoE and their team composition?
Okay, it's Repel Burn for the stun from Leona. He's trying to run away, but big damage comes through from the Lucian, and Heaven Times got pretty much nowhere to go, juking back and forth.
At the same time, he's buying time because the rest of his team is going after that inhibitor again.
Now, this has got to be really, really close, though, because it's a 4-on-5 right here. Lalpro could give up so many kills for this move by greeting. But they're greeting for the inhibitor in a 5v4. There's a little couple of spears coming out from LOD. There's the engage from Pat, and there's the dive in for Wolfsclaw, who takes the Zhonya's to survive the engage, but the burst comes back down. It's a trade 1-for-1, 2-for-1 so far. This fight is going for AoE right now. Hanser's got nowhere to go, flashes the wall, but now the chase is coming in. Morgana's around. It's the minus two overall for the inhibitor. Binding will hit Chump John. They're still gonna keep disengaging in this one. Wolfsclaw gets the slow onto LOH, but he is out of mana now.
Wolfsclaw cannot keep this pursuit up. There's no Baron for them to take.
Chump John can, though.
Chump, he's looking for it. If he can get the Blade Surge into the equilibrium.
Black Shield. Oh, he could have stunned Hanser. He could have stunned Hanser. Maybe try for that one. Doesn't go for it, though.
Good Black Shield there by LOH. Now they have a minion wave up top. They have to deal with super minions. Once again, it's going to start pouring into their base. It was a very risky flank that they pulled off there because Evan RL, he was not at that fight until much later, because he had just backed. He had to home guard himself into that fight, just bought them so he could rush up there. And when the fight started, DeWolfClaw absorbed all of the ultimate of LOD. We're going to see it here. Evan RL, he's running up. DeWolfClaw, boom, right there. Syndra ultimate into nothing. It would have killed him, but instead LOD is the one who gets dropped alongside Hoodstomp in the back line, because Elements allows his team to get there with the engage.
Awesome play by these guys. So they do escape on the end of that one, but it basically means the game is back to equal. 700 gold separates these teams. I feel like I've seen this before. Where AoE is getting more kills, Lalpro tries to push. Top inhibitor is dead. That's actually not the most important inhibitor, though.
No. And
that top Nexus turret's actually been healing up. It was down to about 100 health, but didn't go down. Baron's up in 40 seconds, but Lalpro are pushing in force to the bottom side.
That is the best inhibitor for them to go after right now. There's no turret, and it's complete opposite of where the other super minion is going to be pouring into the base. Baron is up in 28 seconds, but at the same time, that's the least their worries, because there's Pat with the flank.
There comes the engage, but the Cullen goes on to the tanks only. LOD jumped on by Elements, that no one's really helping him go down. Finally, DeWolfsclaw shows up, but LOH is going to get a two-man stun, and Hoodstomp finds the kill onto Pat, and DeWolfsclaw now also barely escapes with his life, binding on Evan RL. This fight is going so nicely for Lalpro. This could be the game. Chump John now forced to run away. Cocoon flashed away from it. Evan RL caught by the binding. The stun comes in as well. Double kill for LOD. That's going to mean inhibitor number two. Minions coming in. Wolfsclaw got to be a bit careful. He does back off underneath the turrets, but there goes the focus onto the Nexus.
Now we see them going straight after. It's really DeWolfsclaw and Chump John left. What can they do?
A bunch of damage. Draven does go down. Hanser has got to be careful as well, but Chump John forced down onto the Fountain. He drops as well. 10 seconds until anyone is back up to defend this base. And 35 minutes in, Lalpro will close it out with a very, very hard-fought series. And unless there's a miracle for Evelynn, that's not going to be the case. 2-0 in an hour and a half of game time. Lalpro pull it in.
In just two games, too. That first one being 55 minutes. Lalpro comes out on top after swapping the game and being under all game long.
Yeah.
This game, they were ahead by a bit, and then AoE got the Baron, and it was just back to bashing heads. And they came up with the right team fights. They kept getting engaged on by Pat.
Yeah.
And that final team fight for them, the damage wasn't there from Evan RL. He was dealing with other people aside from LOD, where Elements and we had also DeWolfsclaw trying to focus him down, and they couldn't get him down.
Yeah, think about how the fights were constructed. I've really got to hand it to Lalpro to find the right kinds of battles. You're facing an Evelynn, a Lucian, a Kassadin, highly mobile champions that are looking for a weird lopsided engagement because they can find them, they can reach them. You bypass wards, you jump over walls, long range abilities, all this stuff. And Lalpro said, no, we're just going to force 5-on-5s. And Kassadin, if you look for the back line, Morgana ulti, DPS coming out from Draven, we're just going to chunk your mid lane mage down and make you useless. Wolfsclaw, he went 5-4-10. He found some chase kills. In fact, his team was still ahead in kills by the time the game ended. But actual team fights, actual 5-on-5s, never seemed to go their way because LoL Pro had the better comp for a dedicated 5-on-5.
And you can get the kills. It was 20-18 in the end with AoE, the team that lost, having more kills. You can get those kills. That's fine. Kills don't end the game. The objectives end the game, blowing up the Nexus. And whenever you get kills, you have to get something else off of it, whether it's a CS lead and you just punish your opponent, or you get a dragon, you get a turret, you start creating pressure. Even if you get a kill and then you set up ward control in an area, it's definitely just multiplicatively better than just killing the person and backing off and being like, okay, I got a kill.
Yeah.
Or win lane. Give yourself all the advantages that you can. And that's what LOL Pro does.
Yeah, and meanwhile, it felt like Area of Effect was, they made good calls reactively, but they never seemed like they set up for their type of game, right? They identified, oh, you guys are low, we can take Baron. Those are good aggressive moves, but they never set up the, okay, it's time for the split push game. It's time to set up Kassadin and Roams and played that type of game for 5 minutes. It was like, can we siege or no? Can we lane or no? And then can we rush a dragon or no? And that was kind of it. So AoE, if they can find some more long-term planning, they'll look a bit better. LoL Pro definitely made a lot of great decisions. LOD was awesome again. He was a big guy to watch out for. So we're going to see them in the semifinals. Now, guys, now the second quarterfinal match is in the books. Let's see now what the updated bracket looks like. With their win, Team LoL Pro is advancing to the semifinals, where they will play Frank Fang Gaming, headed up by Nien in the top lane.
That's true. And there's actually only one more quarterfinal match to go when Team Coast and Team Green Forest battle in a best-of-three match up on June 7th. The winner of that round will go up against Curse Academy, who advanced to the semifinals due to a forfeit by Cloud9 Tempest.
So there's going to be games to watch out for. But before then, there's more LCS action on the way Thursday, when Alliance takes on Rokat and SK Gaming battles Millennium.
Then Super Hot Crew goes up against Fnatic, and the Copenhagen Wolves go against Gambit.
And the EU Challenger quarterfinals pick back up when Denial Esports takes on Loveland Shore.
Coverage begins at 8:30 a.m. Pacific Daylight Time, 4:30 p.m. Central European Summer Time, with the LCS preview show.
And with that, we've reached the end of our time together tonight. Sorry, guys, but before we go, I want to say thanks again to our friends at Coca-Cola. Now for myself, Zyrene, and the entire live broadcast crew, thanks for watching. Good night, GG.